A popular real-life application that uses percentages a lot is in computing interest. Basically, interest is an amount of money that either you earn if you've invested some money or that you owe someone if you've borrowed money. For example, if you, let's say, buy a car and you don't have cash to pay for the car, you can go to a bank and get a loan for the money to pay for the car, but obviously a bank's not going to let you hold on to that money for free while you make those payments back to them. So you'll pay them back the full price that you borrowed plus interest. That would be an amount that you owe them for borrowing money from them. But the reverse is also true. If you have money you're willing to lend to the bank in the form of a savings account or a CD or something like that, where the bank holds on to the money, they'll pay you interest for letting them hold on to your money. And it turns out there's a simple formula that governs what we call simple interest. It looks something like this. It says that the interest earned is equal to P times R times T. And here's what these letters mean. I is obviously interest, I for interest. P stands for principal. Principal is the amount of money that you're investing or borrowing. The interest rate is pretty obvious. That's it's the interest rate. The thing I will say though, when they give you an interest rate for a particular interest problem, they'll write it in the problem as a percentage, 7%, 11%, 9%, 3%. But when we do the math, we cannot use the percentage number. We have to use the decimal representation of the percentage. So when they say 7%, we will have to say 0.07 expressed as a decimal whenever we do all the math. All right, so that's the interest rate expressed as a decimal, and T is going to represent time in years. So let's just think intuitively about this. If you wanted to make some interest, if you wanted to do some investments, what's some things you could vary to fluctuate the amount of interest you would earn? If you wanted to make more interest, you could increase your principal, put in more money into the savings account or the CD or what have you. You could find an investment that has a higher interest rate that'll increase your interest, or you could leave it in there a longer period of time. People who have retirement accounts where they put in money for 20 and 30 years wind up with a lot of money when they retire because they've left it in there for so long. So ideally, you'd like to look for a combination of these. Put in more money in an investment that has a high interest rate and leave it there for a long time, and you stand to make quite a bit of money. But we should learn a lesson from this. The reverse is also true. If you're owing somebody money and paying interest, then you will want to reduce your debts to decrease the principal. You will want to find a good low interest rate and don't borrow money for long periods of time. You'd like to lower those if you're the one paying somebody interest. So it's a two-way street there. So let's look at a basic interest problem. So here we've got a person. His name's Juan, and he invests $4,500 in a CD. You'll see a lot of examples dealing with CDs. Now, they're not talking about CDs that you listen to. They're talking about what's called a certificate of deposit. This is a common investment item where you take an amount of money and you put it in for a fixed period of time, and you get paid a certain amount of interest. There's no strings attached. It's very straightforward. The math is very straightforward. That's why it's very popular to use these when you're talking about investments in an algebra class. It says our CD, our certificate of deposit, has an annual interest rate of 8.3%. There's your interest rate. And we're going to invest that $4,500 for 1 year. That's our time. So how much interest did Juan earn on his CD? So what we would do is we would set up our equation, I equals P times R times T. And basically we fill in the blank. So I equals 4,500 times the interest rate. Now we do not put 8.3. This would way lead us to a wrong answer. So instead, we write 0.083, so that's 8.3% expressed as a decimal, times 1 year, and put that in the calculator. So we'll have 4,500 times 0.083 times 1. And we'll get a total of $373.50. So the amount of interest that Juan earned was $73.50 interest. Now, last little small comment I'll make before I let you go. When most interest rates are less than 10%, typically you can have high interest rates in the double digits, but a very common mistake students make when they have interest rates that are single digits, like 8 or 8.3 in this case, when they convert it to a decimal, they'll say 0.83, but really that's incorrect. That would be like representing 83%, which will give you a crazy wrong answer. So make sure to diligently move this decimal place twice to the left, and instead the interest rate would be 0.083. But other than that, this formula is very straightforward. Now, I will say that these interest examples do get pretty sticky. There's some ways that they can phrase these questions to actually make these some fairly difficult examples that students often struggle with, but we'll look at some of those harder examples coming up in the next video.